Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is a debate on motion 2761 in the name of Angela Constance on tackling drug-related deaths through the first year of the national mission. And can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons or enter R in the chat function on BlueJeans. And I call on Angela Constance to speak to and move the motion. Up to 12 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Every drug death is a tragedy, leaving families, friends and loved ones looking for answers and support. And I offer condolences to everyone who has been impacted by a drug death and reaffirm my commitment to them that I will continue to do everything possible to turn the tide on drug deaths in Scotland. This month marks the first year of the National Mission to Save and Improve Lives, and it is important that Parliament has an opportunity to reflect on the actions taken thus far before looking ahead to the next steps on our journey. The commitment from all parts of this chamber to reduce drug deaths as quickly as possible is giving a sharper focus and more of a shared understanding of what needs to be done. In the last 12 months, we have laid the foundations for the work ahead, getting in and about the issues we face so that we can focus on delivering change on the ground that will make a real and tangible difference to people's lives. We've set out the platforms for change on standards for care, like the MAT standards, and on residential rehabilitation through the milestones I set out at the end of last year. And I'd like to put on record my thanks to the Drugs Death Task Force and the Residential Rehabilitation Working Group for giving us the tools for scaling up and making the necessary changes and improvements going forward. The year ahead begins with the appointment of a new chair to the Drugs Death Task Force. I have asked David Strang to take on this role with immediate effect, and I am delighted that he has accepted. David brings a wealth of relevant experience. He is a former chief constable who has also served as a chief inspector of prisons. And more recently, he has chaired the independent inquiry into mental health services in Tayside. His appointment marks a new chapter for the task force, which has been a valued contributor to the work being done across Scotland. I have asked him and his colleagues on the task force to accelerate their final recommendations planned for this year, aiming to get those for the summer. As we focus now on delivery and change on the ground, we need quicker practical advice from the task force, building on what it has already provided and achieved. The First Minister set us a challenge through the national mission, recognising that real change needed an all-Scotland cross-government, cross-chamber approach. She set out clear priorities to wrap support around those people who are at most risk through fast and appropriate access to treatment, increased access to residential rehabilitation, better support after non-fatal overdoses, and recognising the vital role of frontline, often third sector organisations. The national mission was underpinned by additional funding, £255 million, with £5 million for the end of the previous financial year and £50 million per year for the next 5 years. That included £100 million over 5 years, specifically for residential rehabilitation and aftercare. Dedicated national funding for grassroots organisations and for families and for residential rehabilitation has proved hugely popular, providing direct support to where it is needed. Additional funding has also been used to maintain services during the pandemic, in particular during the lockdown periods when people are more at risk. We have improved emergency responses, increasing the availability of naloxone, which is now carried by ambulance technicians and by police officers in pilot areas. Police Scotland is considering rolling this out nationally, and additional opportunities for naloxone carriage are being explored with our emergency services. Funding has been provided to ADPs for non-fatal overdose pathways. The Glasgow Overdose Response Team is a good example of what is needed all across the country, providing a focused period of support for people after an overdose. The ambulance service has also led the way in the distribution of take-home naloxone and connecting people to services, helping to prevent as well as respond to overdose. Colleagues will have noted the media strategy which ran during the last months of 2021 to raise public awareness of the signs of overdose, the important role of naloxone, and crucially, how to help. And during the first year of the mission, I've taken a balanced approach to treatment and recovery, announcing support for harm reduction through the MAT standards and for recovery through increasing access to residential rehabilitation. Both of these are vital and both are part of a whole system of care, of course.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful for the Minister's taking intervention, and I'm pleased to hear all the steps that have been taken and potentially success. But can I ask her what work the Scottish Government is doing to ensure that as people are rehabilitated and recover, their place is not taken by somebody else who's falling into that trap of addiction?
Minister.
Prevention is of crucial importance, both within our education system, within our early years, the work to prevent poverty, the work to prevent mental health. So the member makes an important point about prevention. On residential rehabilitation, Presiding Officer, last year we published details for the first time on the placements that were available, and we set up funding streams to ensure people could access these. In November, I set out plans to increase the numbers of residential rehab beds by 50% and the publicly funded placements by 300% over the next 5 years. And I signalled the need to move to national commissioning for placements to ensure I'll make a wee bit more progress first, sir. And I signalled the need to move to national commissioning for placements to ensure better consistency across the country. To build a system of fast and appropriate access to treatment, we published the Medicated Assisted Treatment Standards in May last year and set services a stretch target to have these embedded by April 2022. In December, I provided Parliament with the first 6-monthly update on how these standards will be embedded and then sustained and improved. For the first time, we have a commitment of a £40 million plan over 5 years to implement fast and appropriate access to treatment, making the key links between mental health, primary care, advocacy for housing and benefits. Not just now. The standards will ensure people have access to the trauma-informed and psychologically informed services. The standards will help make rights a reality in practice. The standards also include criteria to combat stigma, which remains a significant barrier for people to coming to treatment. In the first half of the year, we supported a group of people with lived and living experience to develop and publish a stigma charter for services to adopt. The additional funding in the first year of the mission also allowed us to run a successful media campaign to raise awareness of stigma, challenging us all to think about how we can all play our part in tackling it, recognising that people need help and not judgement. And we need to be aware of the wider impact that drugs have on families, an important part of our preventative approach. And I announced the launch in December of a new whole family framework with additional funding through ADPs of £3.5 million per year. And this will help local services provide support to families who have been impacted by problematic drug use and adopt a whole family preventative approach in the support that they provide. We have also introduced quarterly reporting of suspected drug deaths for the first time. This allows services to respond more quickly and keeps Parliament informed. And this is a very important step forward, but does not replace the official reports produced annually by National Records of Scotland. If it's really brief.
Stephen Kerr.
Percentages. I want to roll back a bit. You mentioned percentage increases in the number of beds. Can you tell us the exact number of beds we're talking about?
Minister.
So the ambition that I laid out just before Christmas there, Mr Kerr, in relation to residential rehabilitation was to, over the five-year period, ensure that we increase publicly funded placements to residential rehabilitation to at least 1,000 per annum. Presiding Officer, we are moving forward with our commitment to establish a safer drug consumption room to operate within the current legal framework. A new service proposal in Glasgow has been provided, and we are continuing to work closely with the Glasgow Health and Social Care Partnership, the police and the Crown Office to ensure we have a sustainable approach which is clinically and legally safe for staff and those using it. We are serious about this commitment, as we know these facilities have a strong evidence base in saving lives and helping some of our most vulnerable citizens. A fresh proposal will be made to the Lord Advocate once further detail on operation and policing is developed. Presiding Officer, our focus on lived and living experience will be carried forward through the creation of a national collaborative. The independent chair will be announced this month. The national collaborative will be well placed to recognise and understand the impact of trauma and bring together and support the voices of lived and living experience and families, ensuring that they are at the very heart of the national mission to shape and implement a human rights approach that will stand the test of time. In March, I will announce our first treatment target, which reflects the MAT standards. In December, I announce funding for new research into prevalence, and the outputs of that research will help inform future targets. By March, we will also have published evidence on the impact of methadone in poly drug use deaths, as well as an evidence summary on benzodiazepines, which will inform discussions for an expert group which will meet at the end of January to consider the role of benzos in treatment and recovery, and inform our work on stabilisation services as recommended by the task force. This year, I will ensure that plans for the establishment of a national care service is both an opportunity to, no, I'm short of time, thank you, is both an opportunity to improve person-centred care and to put drug and alcohol services on a firmer footing through clearer expectations, standards and accountability. In all of our projects and initiatives, one of the most significant challenges we face is on workforce. We are currently mapping the workforce, including existing training capacity. Over the next year of the mission, we will be focused on increasing capacity and training to ensure the delivery of the national mission. I will also continue to work closely with ministerial colleagues to focus on action to support people with multiple complex needs, joining up mental health, justice, homelessness and others. And I am particularly keen to see more progress around justice issues, which will include better through care, especially for people on release from prison. And I will return to Parliament with justice colleagues in spring. And I will continue to press for the introduction of drug check-in facilities, which could also save lives if we were allowed to do this in Scotland. The task force has funded a project to research and scope the key components required to implement drug check-in facilities in three areas of Scotland, Dundee, Glasgow and Aberdeen, and we expect applications for the first of these to be submitted to the Home Office by the end of February. And finally, Presiding Officer, in the first year of this national mission, solid foundations have been laid, but much remains to be done. And my focus and that of this Government will be on delivery on the ground, where it matters most. I look forward to members' contributions and I move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Sue Webber to speak to and move Amendment 2761.2 up to 8 minutes. Ms Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw the Chamber's attention to my register of interests, both as a City of Edinburgh councillor and as a member of the Edinburgh Alcohol and Drug Partnership, and I move the amendment in my name. I welcome the chance to speak in such an important debate. I want to do all I can to look for the positives, to reflect on the cross-party ambition and willingness to work together to tackle and reduce our country's shocking and shameful drug-related deaths. Today, we are asked to consider the first year and next steps. I know we all want to see evidence of real improvements in services and the support for those who desperately need help, and we want to save people from dying needlessly. However, in Scotland today, people are still being denied access to the addiction treatment that they need, while the drug death rate has almost tripled on the SNP's watch. The SNP's devastating handling of the crisis has been thrown into further chaos by the recent resignation of members of the Drug Deaths Task Force, but I'd like to acknowledge today and welcome the appointment of Mr David Strang. Anne-Marie Ward, Chief Executive Officer of Favour, has said, "We stood by helplessly while friends become more traumatised by the day. We have witnessed friends and family die, watching the slow car crash as each reached out for help that was more often than not wasn't there. The absence of hope in our treatment systems is not only damaging to service users, but to those working in services. I stated yesterday in the debate on mental health, and it's just as valid today, that how can a workforce that has reached burnout deliver compassionate care when they themselves face periods of stress and anxiety, and they watch people's lives destroyed by substance misuse daily? As my amendment states, the next phase of action must also include preventative measures and policies. Ones that ensure those are helped with their recovery are not replaced, as Mr Whittle has just said, by more people who fall into that cycle of addiction. To do this, we must understand why Scotland has the crisis it has. What is unique to Scotland that causes so many drug-related deaths? Only then can we create a preventative agenda that will work to save lives in Scotland. This is one of the reasons the Scottish Conservatives have launched our Right to Recovery Bill, which will ensure that those with addiction issues are able to access the necessary treatment they require. I have had the invaluable opportunity to speak to stakeholders and those with lived experiences who will have submitted responses to the calls for consultation, and I would like to thank them all for taking the time to engage with the bill and for sharing the issues they still face 12 months on. Some say, and there has been criticism, that there are flaws in the bill, but those working with us have hit back. Right now, the treatment system in Scotland lacks the quality, the diversity and the capacity to fulfil its potential in protecting people from substance use-related harms, including drug-related deaths. And Stephen Wishart said, the proposed bill does address this. It ensures equal funding must be provided to allow local authorities and NHS health boards to perform its duties. It also, importantly, shifts the balance of power from the opinion of individual decision makers and to the right of the person to choose what their plan is. And yes, we welcome the £250 million to tackle drug deaths. It should not have taken the 14 years to finally realise that the drug policies had failed and that families had been failed and entire communities let down and broken. And this is why the Scottish Conservatives are pushing forward with our proposals for a Right to Recovery Bill. With the consultation now closed, it was astounding to see the level of interaction and submission from across the country. We have received overwhelming support. And again, I would like to acknowledge and thank everyone that took the time to submit their views on the Right to Recovery Bill. As I said, the £250 million worth of funding is welcome, but the SNP government has sadly refused to sign up to the UK-wide scheme to help tackle drug dealing. Project Adder would have provided investment designed to tackle addiction and the supply of illegal substances. Yes, I will.
Minister.
Grateful. Presiding Officer, my understanding via my officials, via UK Government officials, is that there was no extra resource attached to Project Adder should Scotland participate. And if I am blunt, the proposal from the UK Government was to rebadge work that we were already doing and to describe that as Project Adder.
Sue Webber.
Thank you, President. Thank the Minister for their intervention. But surely the SNP should be doing everything possible and taking any approach possible to tackle our national crisis, rather than playing party politics yet again and refusing to engage with Westminster. It is tiresome and unnecessary when we all know we must work together to save lives. Across the country, alcohol and drug partnership meetings have taken on a more upbeat feel, a more positive feel, for the first time in years. More funding has helped as they strive to have the new MAT standards embedded within their area by April 2022. However, this is where things start to go wrong. April 2022 is only 4 months away, yet we have had ADPs across the country starting from very different places. We have ADPs already admitting they will not be able to establish and embed all of these standards by this timeline, including Edinburgh, who have an established pre-existing service with many of the standards. Half of the ADPs who didn't respond to the Public Health Scotland survey said they had yet to set up a pathway to residential rehabilitation. Other reasons given for the ADPs not responding to the survey on residential rehabilitation were 42% because it said there were no referrals received, and 8% said there was no staff available to complete the template. Astounding, absolutely astounding. Such variation in services across the country underpins the inequalities we face. We need to wake up, and it's this very reason that people need the right to recovery, as it is clear the SNP has failed to support residential rehabilitation. The SNP government only funded 13% of residential rehab places in Scotland in 2019-20, and furthermore, the number of government-funded places for residential rehab declined throughout 2020 2021, from 47 placements in March to 36 in September. That's some way and is a long way of reaching that 1,000. I want to take some time to acknowledge the invaluable work that's going on in my city, Edinburgh. The VOW project is a Police Scotland service led, consisting of 4 police officers and 3 peer mentors. It aims to empower young people involved in the criminal justice system to break the cycle of offending by providing support to people deemed to be at significant risk of drug-related harm in the community. This assertive outreach relies on the unique experiences of peer mentors who have lived experience and the police officers the access to a wide professional network of contacts, and they can provide opportunities for training and employment. There is no doubt this project has saved lives, but funding is an issue. Tackling drug-related deaths should always be a priority, which is why the Scottish Conservatives launched our Right to Recovery Bill. Anne-Marie, Chief Executive Officer of Favour today, said, "Enshrining people's rights in law would ensure access and choice to a plethora of services over and over, and it's nothing short of incredible. This legislation is a starting point to people being able to access services that at the moment are not even available. I hope this chamber continues to demonstrate consensus and collaboration on tackling the complex issues involved in drug-related deaths. It is our national shame, and we should all support the Right to Recovery Bill, making a recovery a legislative certainty in the very least these people deserve." Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Claire Baker to speak to and move Amendment 2761.1. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So we are a year on from the First Minister's announcement, and this debate is an opportunity to examine the progress and to focus on the next steps. So a year ago, a declaration was made, a national mission was announced, and an acknowledgement of failure was given. A year on, the early indications of progress on reversing the high rate of fatalities in Scotland, by far the highest in Europe and more than 3 times that of England and Wales, is slow. The recent Police Scotland data showed a slight decrease, but that suggests a plateau rather than progress. Perhaps at this stage, the government would argue that more progress couldn't be expected. We are at early stages, but when will it be? The funding commitment is for 5 years. Is that the aim of the national mission, and what will success look like? Today, as we reflect on policy and responses to the crisis, it should be with a critical eye if we are to have confidence that progress will be made and to focus on the further action that is required. So over the past year, I do recognise there has been activity. This includes the medical assisted treatment standards, plans to increase capacity in residential rehabilitation facilities, and the expansion of the recorded police warning scheme, though more investment is needed in all of these if they are to make a difference. Our amendment talks about the need to fully resource the MAT standards implementation. In June, the Minister committed £4 million to the first 2 standards being implemented as a priority. The 6-month update we had recently didn't share any data to demonstrate progress. We only have the Minister's word on that. The commitment is for full implementation by April. Will that be achieved? A briefing today from the Royal College of Psychiatrists highlights the need for more support for health boards and IGBs who are struggling to meet the standards, a focus on leadership, and a need for increased staffing levels. And an amendment talks about barriers to residential rehab. How will the Minister ensure that expansion in capacity will address equal access? I am looking for support for our amendment today, but we will support a united voice in Parliament. However, the Minister's motion does lack acknowledgement of the failure of the Scottish Government to act much earlier when fatalities began to spiral upwards, or to set out a clear course of action. While I fully recognise that addictions of the modern era in Scotland is fuelled by a significant industrial change, unemployment and deprivation, trauma and mental health, the responsibility of government is to respond, and the drugs test crisis represents a failure of government in recent years. It shows the devastating impact of what can happen when focus isn't given to critical issues which were allowed to escalate as policies continued on the mistaken path. Lives could have been saved if action had been taken earlier. But while I welcome several announcements made in the last year, there is still much work to be done. And a year ago, the First Minister stated support for adopting safe consumption rules in Scotland and to exploring how to overcome the barriers to doing so. And in the past year, we've had a number of statements from the Government on the work underway. I was seeking assurances that we're moving further forward, and I do appreciate the Minister's comments today on a Glasgow proposal, sounding like it's coming closer, and I support her in pushing forward this plan with other agencies. Also, while Wales has had a drug-taking service since 2013, we are still to get the pilots started. And although a commitment was given, there is a lack of progress on expanding heroin-assisted treatment, and that is important in reducing fatalities, as well as blood-borne viruses, as the Hepatitis C Trust have highlighted. So accountability, transparency and scrutiny are essential going forward, and that is why Labour's amendment is calling for an independent review, a kind of audit of activity. And I do await more information on the national collaborative that the Minister has referred to today and whether they could play a role in the need for this. The First Minister stated a year ago the importance of a clear focus on what works and the need to evaluate interventions so we know what works and what does not. A review should not only cover the recommendations of the Drugs Death Task Force, but also other measures that have been announced by the government, so we can assess how effective these interventions are and identify quickly where further change is needed. There is a balance between urgency and evidence-led policy making. That is a challenge for the Minister. I do share her frustration at the lack of change, the pace of change, but we must not lose sight of the importance of informed policy making. The resignations of the Chair and the Vice-Chairs of the Drug Death Task Force did reflect a breakdown in relationships between the Scottish Government and the task force that they appointed. It is unfortunate in that by pushing for urgency, something the Government itself hadn't demonstrated for a long time, they created a situation of uncertainty and conflict, and steps must be taken to avoid that negatively impacting on the ongoing work of the task force. I do welcome the clarity today over the appointment of David Strang as the Chair, and I wish him well in leading their work. Their contribution is important, and I would urge the Minister to work constructively with them and support completion of the work. The task force, of course, already made recommendations, and we need to hear what progress has been made with these, including evaluations and updates. The recent report by the Criminal Justice Committee in the Parliament raised concerns at the lack of progress in implementation of the drug force recommendations and called for much faster progress to be made. We also need increased transparency over the national mission and related work which demonstrates an inclusive report. The National Drugs Mission Implementation Group, chaired by the Minister, was set up to drive action across government and services and to oversee delivery of the task force recommendations. It was due to meet every 3 months, but information on the Scottish Government website shows a meeting took place in June 2021 and it gives no indication of whether it's met since then, and there are no minutes available. This does little to instil confidence in the process or transparency. So can the Minister, when she concludes, advise on additional meetings of the implementation group and outline its current work? Presiding Officer, the national mission must be more than a statement. It has to save lives and it has to build futures. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I start by welcoming this debate and reaffirming my good wishes to Angela Constance and her work. This is something I think all parties want her to succeed on. Can I also welcome the appointment of David Strang? I know David Strang from work with him over prison reform and some matters relating to constituents, and I've always found him to be a man of deep compassion and intellect, so I welcome him to his place. I also start by acknowledging the political progress that has been made on this subject. A year ago, we were debating this on a motion in the name of Monica Lennon, and it was customary for it to be opposition time that was afforded to the drug deaths emergency. I'm gratified now the government are leading such debates in government's time, but still progress is painfully slow. Last summer, we know that Scotland hit a particularly grim milestone, and I'm sure everyone in this chamber is familiar with that, with more than 1,300 people dying of drug overdoses, which is the worst drug death Scotland has seen for the 7th year running. Our mortality rate is still 3.5 times higher than our English and Welsh counterparts, and higher than that of any other European country. While deaths are the main focus of today's debate, it is also worth mentioning and noting that addiction has devastating consequences both from cradle to grave. In fact, it was revealed just last week by my party through Freedom of Information that since 2017, the devastating reality that 850 babies, more than 850 babies, have been born with neonatal abstinence syndrome. Not only does this have immediate and painful side effects for newborns, such as seizures, tremors and breathing difficulties, but it can also have serious development and cause serious developmental issues. Presiding Officer, it is hard to imagine a more difficult start to life. And I've talked about that several times, particularly the work I did outside of this place in that regard. And to solve this crisis, to identify solutions, we have to shift away from the view that addiction is perceived as a criminal issue. And we are starting to do that. It is a debilitating and consuming sickness, masking unresolved pain, born sometimes out of mental health conditions, economic circumstances, and in some cases it is also even a rite of passage in some communities. To be properly treated, this illness must be met with empathy and a holistic understanding of the factors that contribute to it. This is an approach the Lib Dems have been campaigning alongside others, particularly in the Labour Party, for a very long time. The Royal College of Physicians advises us that while we are in desperate need of direct policies to attract, to tackle drug deaths, we have to address the impact that such factors as employment, social security and housing all have as contributing factors to addiction. They say there must be a joined up approach and joined up care across all of these stables for people who struggle with addiction to tackle this epidemic from all angles, in their words. Presiding officer, why then, despite the expertise of the Royal Colleges, is the government not always heeding this advice? It is only 2 weeks ago, as we know, that the head of the Drugs Task Force, Katrina Matheson, and her deputy resigned. Why? Because they said they couldn't cope with the government's drive to meet their targets quickly rather than on achieving them on a sustainable basis. I hope that David Strang is afforded more latitude to complete his work at a rate that works. And sustainable change can be achieved by precise action and expertise. We know that, and we only need to look for international examples like our near neighbours in Portugal, who have grappled with issues like this and succeeded. That is why I and my party have previously called on the help of the World Health Organization to provide a specialist task force for Scotland, which could help lend international expertise and what works, solutions that work, to help tackle our drugs death epidemic head on. And my party has also called for safe consumption spaces for a long time, following the heroic efforts of people such as Peter Crikand, and before he came to this place, Paul Sweeney, in providing spaces for safe consumption and clean equipment. The risk of drug mortality reduces considerably by reducing the deadly rate of infections such as hepatitis and other vital impacts. Moreover, we have also campaigned for an increase in rehabilitation services. So it is, of course, encouraging to hear the measures the government are working on towards such efforts and to increase the capacity of rehabilitation in this country by 50%. But more can and should be done. And we also need to match that with a recognition of problems in our stabilisation services. I have discussed personally with Angela Constance the problems we face in stabilisation services. And I hope she will address the government's commitment to that in her closing remarks, because we cannot get people into meaningful rehabilitation until we've actually stabilised the various chaotic aspects of their lifestyle before that happens. Like I mentioned before, more must be done to provide a united approach across different services. Very recently, however, we've heard extremely troubling reports that those in drug and alcohol rehabilitation must leave rehabilitation immediately, otherwise they could lose their council homes and tenancies. Presiding officer, is snatching away people's homes really an appropriate way to treat those that are in such need of desperate help? Considering that it would be perfectly plausible for the government to use emergency housing funding to help people keep their homes and tenancies while they undergo this vital treatment. This is something that the Liberal Democrats have repeatedly called for, and again, I ask for the government to reflect on that in their closing remarks. The motion that we're debating today also considers safe consumption facilities an important measure and supports all options within the existing legal framework. The law, however, is not as black and white as the SNP would lead us to believe. The government could be pushing and challenging the boundaries of law to break the legal impasse and properly introduce safe consumption rooms. After all, this was confirmed by the Lord Advocate a few months ago when my party pushed for a review into the laws. Presiding officer, above all else, it must be remembered today that every drug-related death that occurs is a tragedy, but the rate and scale of this make this a particularly Scottish tragedy. It is a preventable loss of life among people in need of compassion and support, not judgment, and help instead of punishment. It's a mark of modern and liberal society of how readily and effectively we offer assistance to those that need it most. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As politicians, we can all come to this chamber with our views on how to help people in Scotland at risk of death from drug use. But it is incumbent on all of us to reach out and speak to those with experience. I do not have personal experience, neither professionally or personally, and I am acutely aware of that every time I engage on this issue. I have not felt the pain as a mum of seeing my children struggle with addiction, wondering if they will ever become healthy again, wondering if one day I might get that phone call. But I have spoken to families for whom it is a constant fear. Drug addiction doesn't have a type, but it does have some very stubborn root causes that some are more at risk of than others. And for every intervention that Ms. Constance has outlined over the past year, we must remember that poverty is the most egregious of those causes. And no one standing up today should ever ignore that root cause, one that is many decades old in the making, and one that, in addition to the mitigations the government, drugs and alcohol agencies and clinicians can make, sits stubbornly in the room like the proverbial elephant. Ms. Constance has said in the past many times that she wants to throw the kitchen sink at this. She says she'll consider anything if it works. And I was pleased to see the pledge for £1.1 million over the 3 years for projects to monitor progress on the interventions that are being made. These include surveillance projects on new problem drug use prevalence estimates, hospital-based toxicology studies, and improvements to the National Drug-Related Deaths Database. These projects are vital because we need to know what is working and what is not, because we have no time to waste. Presiding officer, we need to leave entrenched political ideology at the door. Some politicians in this chamber have, over the time that I've been here, been far too wary of following other countries' radical but ultimately successful approaches. Alec Cole-Hamilton's just mentioned one of them in Portugal. Too stuck on purely abstinence-based recoveries, too quick to dismiss safe consumption facilities, and not recognising that people suffering from addiction can also have caring responsibilities that mean they need wraparound care and treatment that takes those responsibilities into account. Not only do I believe that some of these entrenched views are stigmatising, I believe they're unrealistic given the complex nature of addiction. Helping people recover from addiction and stay recovered is our goal. The way we get there will require myriad approaches, and not all of them are traditional political vote winners. One of the most significant of the government's interventions is the implementation of the medication-assisted treatment standards across Scotland. And still on stigma, we must all be resolute in our assertion that what we're talking about is a health issue, and we need to stop constantly referring to it as a justice one for those who are addicted. The tone and rhetoric of some of the Conservative MSPs questioning the Lord Advocate on her announcement on the diversion from prosecution was slightly disappointing in that regard. This is a significant move which seeks to aid them in recovery for victims, not compound their trauma by putting them into the justice system. I'd also like to implore politicians and the media, please stop using the word shame when discussing the issue, no matter how it's meant. The mental health debate yesterday had some moving and quite personal speeches from MSPs across the chamber. But for some of our citizens, poor mental health leads to reliance on drugs or alcohol, which can turn into life-threatening addiction. This manifestation is not a lifestyle choice. It's very often a symptom of trauma and of poor mental health. If the law is a barrier to recovery, it but simply must be changed. And I'm looking forward to asking UK Government Minister Kit Malthouse in early February about the UK laws that prohibit the use of safe consumption rooms in a joint session with the committee I convene on health, social care and sport, and the Criminal Justice Committee. Presiding officer, I come back to where I started, my determination to always consult with those with experience whenever I speak on drugs policy. So with that in mind, I asked my colleagues at Alcohol and Drug Action in Aberdeenshire what they think of the policy interventions of the Scottish Government in the last 12 months. And I'll end by quoting Director Fraser Hogan. He said this, "In Aberdeenshire, there are issues not only around opiate users where MAT standards are very much welcomed, but we also recognise increases in polydrug use within a younger age group. We need to ensure that within the investment plan that we create an adaptive and flexible treatment system. specialist services that will emphasise and include vital preparatory work that's trauma-informed, care and stabilisation opportunities, and post-care such as reintegration planning for any rehabilitation placement. There is a need to consider broader aspects that ensure relevant assessment processes and a wider wraparound and more joined up of wider health and social providers. So increasing the range of treatment options is indeed essential, but also those involved in delivering them is crucial. It is important to stress that rehabilitation beds in themselves won't succeed even with the best of intentions if we don't have a systems-based approach. MAT standards will be very much a key lever for opiate users at high risk, but we must broaden the standards further, given that many of those suffering non-fatal and fatal OD are polydrug users with a wide variety of other underlying and social issues. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased once again to get the opportunity to speak in the Chamber on tackling Scotland's drug death shame. And those furthest from society during this pandemic have suffered disproportionately. We have endured nearly 2 years where isolation and lack of public contact has been the mandated position. But for those caught in addiction, isolation and lack of contact is the worst of all worlds. Without doubt, COVID will have significantly impacted drug and alcohol consumption and deaths. Much has been said over the last 5 years in this chamber on this subject, and it is fair to say that although it took far too long for the Scottish Government to acknowledge the severity of the issues, with the First Minister admitting that the Scottish Government have taken their eye off the ball, action has been taken at long last, much of which, I have to say, had been repeatedly called for by the Scottish Conservatives, especially on the reinvestment in rehabilitation beds, which had been so drastically cut. In the last debate in the last term, the Scottish Conservatives recognised the debate had to move on. And despite serious reservations, we voted with a government motion that included exploring the viability of safe consumption rooms. In terms of safe consumption rooms as the most effective way of deploying public funds and tackling addiction issues, I have to say these reservations remain. But the debate on solving this crisis cannot be allowed to hang on that particular issue. So, as the government motion says, this debate is about the first year of the new measures, their effectiveness and what steps have to be taken next. We have had a year of putting measures in place to tackle the immediate crisis, helping those with the most urgent and chronic addiction problems and ensuring they get the treatment they desperately need, something the Scottish Conservatives would like to enshrine in law with that right to recovery. Of course, this is an understandable first step. However, I would like to discuss how we ensure that as we help each person with their rehabilitation and recovery, that their place is not just taken by somebody else who has fallen into that addiction trap. In other words, how we develop policies that help people help prevent people stepping into that life in the first place, or at the very least, catch the problem as early as possible before it reaches crisis point. That, of course, is more complicated, it's more long-term. Nonetheless, it is absolutely critical that we address this. Understanding the reasons for addiction, specifically why Scotland has such a poor record, is a critical first step in developing a strategy to tackle addiction, something I think the Minister and I have debated and discussed before, and I think that debate probably will continue. According to the conclusions from a conference, A Matter of Life and Death, at which there were some 110 organisations associated with prevention and treatment of drug and alcohol abuse, some of the main causes of drug and alcohol misuse include marginalisation and exclusion, loneliness, lack of a social structure, poor relationships, lack of protective factors, self-medication associated with masking the pain of ACEs and previous trauma, stigma, self-deprecation, barriers to achievement and homelessness. And I joined the Scottish Affairs Committee at Westminster. Of course I will.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much for taking the intervention. The list of reasons why people take drugs there, the one that was blatantly missing that I could see was poverty. Would you not accept poverty as a major contributor to drug use?
Brian Whittle.
Can I thank Mr. Fairley for the intervention, because that was my very next sentence. I joined the Scottish Affairs Committee at Westminster in the last Parliament for their investigation into deprivation and addiction. And it concluded that although deprivation doesn't necessarily cause addiction. Deprivation and inequality make the above more acute, leading to a more likely situation where there is an inability to access quality treatment and help, a lack of access to general community services, an unmet complex health need, and a lack of effective support structure. So although in Mr Fairley's intervention there, he rightly cites poverty, and that particular committee, which is chaired by one of his own, the conclusion was that it wasn't necessarily the cause of an addiction. But there are interventions which are successful around the country. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. There are many people and organisations out there on the front line who have lived experience doing great work. Much of the solution is about supporting work that is already there. I think the most effective tools the Scottish Government have at their disposal to tackle the scourge of addiction and deaths from addiction lie in education and in health and in the third sector, responsibility for which has been totally devolved to this Parliament for 20 years. And I would say to this chamber that successive governments' inability to create legislation, investment and focus to this issue is an abject failure of this Parliament. So make no mistake, the Scottish Government has a significant toolbox to radically alter the approach to addiction and therefore to the outcomes. I would highlight within these actions we must recognise non-clinical interventions, that this is not an attempt to replace clinical services, rather it is augmenting them, and I fear that we are medicalising human distress. Clinical and third sector partnership solutions must include financial partnerships. I know the Minister recognises this, but we have had these conversations before, Presiding Officer, and there are too many instances where the third sector organisations who are interacting with the most isolated of patients are not getting access to the funding that the Scottish Government have deployed. So the suggestions are, Presiding Officer, if I may, I would like to see a range of support within one location, a one-door approach, services working together to reflect the needs of individuals and families in the treatment plan, services available within communities and a sense of feeling connected, sharing information and continuity of care, that need for a more joined-up working between addiction services and community mental health. Presiding Officer, long-term solutions rely on us understanding why Scotland has such a disproportionate bad record in drug deaths and addiction. And I would like to hear an appropriate response, and hopefully the Minister will answer that in summary, because long-term, to tackle this crisis, the solution must include prevention. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Paul McLennan to be followed by Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thanks for the opportunity to speak in this debate this afternoon. 1 year of the national mission, a mission to save lives and improve lives. In preparing the speech, I reminded myself of the main aims of the national mission: fast and appropriate access to treatment and support through all services, improved frontline drug services, including the third sector. Services in place and working together to react immediately and maintain support for as long as needed. Increased capacity in and in use of residential rehabilitation, and more joined-up approach across policies to address underlying issues. I recently met with MELDAP, the Mid and East Lothian Drug Partnership, to discuss how I could help and add value to the mission in East Lothian. East Lothian actually seen a slight drop in drug deaths from 18 to 14 last year. Most of the deaths, like many in Scotland, were long-term users with existing issues, and many were multiple drug users. Again, like Scotland, many were from a poorer background, but not all. But that's 14 lives in East Lothian lost, 14 families suffering. Over the next 5 years, £250 million will be spent on addressing the crisis, and the Scottish Government is determined that every penny of this additional funding will make a difference. The first year of the mission has seen many discussions, consultation and honest, frank discussions. We need to move on to implementation. The Scottish Drugs Task Force was set up in 2019 and looked at some key strategies. I want to focus on a few of these. First one is stigma. I don't think we underestimate this at all. For years, we've heard phrases bandied about, he's just a junkie, just a pothead, they're just a waster. People threw about the comments without thinking about the impact. Stigma affects individuals, families, in communities. People with drug and alcohol problems often see themselves in a way that reflects the prejudice and judgment of others. That's still not there. That's not going away. Sometimes this overrides any sense of self-worth or self-esteem. There are also strong links between stigma, well-being and mental health problems, as we've already heard. And I want to reflect on a constituent who I've known for a long period of time. Our families grew up probably 200 or 300 yards away from each other. I've seen him struggle with addictions over that period of time. It's about 30 years. I've seen him verbally abused by other people on a local high street on a number of occasions. I've seen him in tears because of that. One time he came up across and spoke to me and said, Paul, I just need help. I hate being like this, and that's stuck with me. His mental health has suffered. He's a good lad who realises he just requires that joined-up approach that we're talking about. And on family members, I know some people were on the drugs and alcohol cross-party groups a few weeks ago. We heard about family members also affected by stigma. This can limit their ability to get help for their loved ones. And it's tiring for them. That was the word we kept on hearing. It's tiring, it's tiring, it's tiring. It may also stop them from seeking help for themselves. Family support. Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Brian Whittle.
I appreciate the member taking the intervention. And on that point of stigma, I've also heard the horrible phrase that there's a hierarchy of death. And by that, what they mean is what appears on the birth certificate will determine how the family are then treated. You know, so if drug death appears on a health certificate, they tend to be stigmatised as well. I don't know if you would agree with that.
Yeah, I certainly do. And I think one of the key things, I think we've now moved on from this, seeing almost being criminalised issue until the health problems. So I think that's a really important point. I'm glad the member brought that up. So the other thing as well is I think communities, you know, and communities with problem substance use are also stigmatised. This can be used as a case when substance use is higher, it's just seen to be higher. This means the whole community can be defined by substance use. Now, I've been a councillor for 15 years, and I've heard that some areas, you know, if you go into that house area, there are certain types of people that live there. And communities are often to refer to that. And again, that brings down communities and makes them feel bad. So this can cause communities and residents to feel cut off and isolated. Again, we need to make sure that we're working with communities to make sure that doesn't go on. So why does tackling stigma matter? It can make people feel uncomfortable asking for help and then can reach a crisis point. And I think when I mentioned that the chap that came and spoke to me, and I think that was part of the problem. He was seen to be stigmatised. This also stops issues in mental health and physical health, housing and a debt also being addressed because it's a much broader problem than that. The other thing I want to talk about is the medication-assisted treatment, and I think that's really important. And it's all about access, choice and support. This is key. So what do the standards mean for people who actually use and provide the services and support? And one thing I'd probably ask the Cabinet Secretary to touch on when she winds up is how do we monitor that? And how do we monitor that almost on a local authority basis? So that needs to be consistent right across the country. It means people who can get a prescription or their treatment support can request on the day they present on any part of the service. People also have the right to involve others, and we talked about family support. And the few times I've been in a cross-party group on drugs and alcohol, that's one key thing is how much that family support is relished. Staff also need to help people to choose this form of support. We need to ensure information again around about independent advocacy services are available and people feel able to use them to discuss the issues that matter to them. Again, this needs to be as local as possible. And again, it needs to be consistent across Scotland. And again, I'll maybe ask the Cabinet Secretary to refer to that. How do we monitor that? We need to make everyone aware that the treatment is not conditional or on abstinence from subsidies or uptake from other interventions and information and advice and recovery opportunities within the community that is well known. So what do the standards mean for staff across all the services as well? And I think that's a really important part. We've got to think about who's providing the services. Staff can feel confident and supported to discuss and offer all treatment and care options for MAT on the first day a person presents. Where a staff member is not trained to do this, they should be able to use a clear pathway to refer a person onto the same day to colleagues who can. Presiding officer, in conclusion, we've made an encouraging start. We've raised awareness of the national mission, but as MSPs, we have a role to lead in our communities, making it a mission for our constituencies and be advocates for people and their families. Thank you.
Thank you. And before I call Michael Mara, can I just ask members who wish to speak in the debate to please make sure they've pressed the request to speak buttons. And I call Michael Mara. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Much has already been said on the recent developments around the Drug Deaths Task Force. I don't intend to take up too much of my time reviewing this unfortunate set of circumstances. Governments do not get everything right. Some governments get very little right. But we should welcome when, if they believe their approach is not working, they do actually change course. But we are all concerned as to the pace of progress. It cannot be allowed to replicate the glacial pace of recognition and acceptance of responsibility from the government of this astonishing national shame. The cost of that neglect and delay is measured in lives more than it is by time. The impact on my home city of Dundee, the North East region I represent, and of course the whole country, are huge. Our community remains deeply frustrated that the situation is still of such desperate failure, with continuing trends of death, destruction, and devastation to families and communities across Scotland. As our amendment and our actions have shown so far, Labour strongly supports the MAT standards and wish to see them in practice consistently across the country with the urgency that the Minister consistently speaks of. These reforms, to be implemented universally in a matter of weeks, are being demanded at an unprecedented pace but are of course responding to an unprecedented situation. The Minister, I know, will hear more even regularly than I do the well-founded concerns of agencies and experts on how this can be achieved, but we cannot allow inertia to prevail, neither can we ignore the huge distances that some services have to travel. I would like to place on record my thanks to the Minister and the Minister for Social Care for meeting with myself and the Brechin Healthcare Group before Christmas to hear about the fantastic work they are doing and the challenges they face. And the goodwill and receptiveness from ministers was evident and appreciated from the meeting, but I still left with very real concern about how these MAT standards will be implemented in rural and semi-rural areas, which have lost so many health services over the last 14 years. But of course, even in Scotland's urban areas, the reality of service access meets the rhetoric of ambition is set out in this chamber. In Dundee, the absence of a functioning same-day prescription service has been central to the tragedy that continues to plague the city. It's now 3 years since the publication of the Dundee Drugs Commission report, which had at its core the need for these services to be operational and working in tandem with support for people. Since the report, far more than 195 people have died. That number reflects the published statistics and not those we have lost since last summer. It's a trend that has continued upwards for a decade and which shows no signs of reversing. The 2-year assessment by the Independent Commission on what has happened with the implementation of the report is now concluding. Now, I've not had sight of that report, but given the many discussions I have had, I would be greatly surprised if it were to say anything other than very little change has taken place. Services have been rebadged, tests of change, as these things are now called, have been started. But I can see nothing which has radically altered the situation facing Dundonians. And none of the urgent action that is needed to meaningfully improve the life chances of those in need of support. I may sound pessimistic, but those more than 200 lost Dundonians and the grief of their families is the fatal proof. And David Strang is no stranger to the challenge of systems that resist change rather than embrace them, given how slow the implementation of his report into mental health services in Tayside has been. A Scottish Drug Forum report assessing progress towards the implementation of MAT standards across the country has found that just 8% of participants in their research had access to same-day prescribing. The interminable delays in Dundee service change must not be tolerated across Scotland. So this debate marks the first anniversary of what the Minister calls the National Mission. It is a mission with, unfortunately, little real success to show, and in all honesty, I find it difficult to describe what the realistic evidence-based intent of the mission is. Certainly.
Brian Whittle. For Mr Marr for taking an intervention. Does he agree with me that we need to get to grips of the why Scotland is caught in such an addiction trap before we can actually get to a proper solution?
I absolutely agree with that point. Absolutely agree. If it's a mission we should all share, then everyone must know the story and the intent. Why is Scotland's drug death record the worst in the world by such a huge distance? Is a key question. Why, when we have the same drug laws as the rest of the UK, are Scotland's drugs deaths 3.5 times as high? And a year on, Scotland is yet to hear the answers to those vital questions from the Minister of this government. And I have to say that what has came through the Dundee Drug Commission, a picture of what the local problem has been, the character of it, the kinds of drugs, what in what situation, the why and the where, was absolutely critical to any form of proper analysis that the public can buy into. And I want to hear more from the Minister in that regard. In order for there to be leadership out of this crisis, to walk alongside families, individuals and communities, we need to hear that story of why. In the early part of the last decade, under this government, prescribing policy changed to stop the dispensing of Valium. That led directly to an illicit street market for cheap, toxic replica drugs. It's the most lethal policy error of devolution, and it's opened a Pandora's box of unintended consequences. Why did it happen? What warnings were made and ignored? How can we avoid this happening again if the tragedy is not recognised and explained? I hope the conclusion of the task force may be a moment for the Minister to answer these questions, the questions of why, and to tell a painful story to which we must all write a better ending.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Mara. I now call on Emma Harper, who joins us remotely, who will be followed by Gillian Mackay. Ms Harper, in 6 minutes, please.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this important debate this afternoon. And like colleagues across Chamber, I too would like to offer my condolences to family, friends and loved ones of those who have lost their lives. I appreciate the huge amount of work that the Minister and the Task Force have put in place already, and I thank them all. Today, I'd like to focus my contribution on two areas. One is tackling stigma and action to address drug-related stigma, and two, the naloxone treatment for people struggling with addiction in rural areas of Scotland. Presiding Officer, drug-related stigma is damaging, not only to the individual in terms of their mental health and the sense of self-worth, but it also discourages people from coming forward to obtain the help they need. And the Minister and Paul McLennan and Gillian Martin have spoke about stigma also already. And by addressing stigma and the silence and alienation it causes, we can make it easier for people to seek help, which will benefit everyone. I absolutely welcome and endorse the vital and important work of We Are With You, which includes stigma reduction and is supported by the Scottish Government, and the stigma charter that's described by the Minister. It is good that active measures are being taken forward to address stigma, and this will be one issue discussed in my upcoming meeting with Dumfries and Galloway's Alcohol and Drugs Partnership Chair. In my previous role as clinical nurse educator, prior to coming to Parliament, I had absolutely great value in the role of education for all health specialties, and I support the fact that education can be delivered in different ways, especially during the pandemic, as face-to-face seminars has not been available. We do need to reduce prejudice, discrimination and stigma associated. And I have had feedback from the nurses and support workers who work in alcohol and drug services who even feel discriminated against themselves for actively assisting people who have a need for medical help, support and intervention so that recovery from harm can start. There still persists the view across the public that people experience harmful use of drugs and alcohol are just lowlives and criminals who don't deserve anyone's help. They need our help. They are our sons and our daughters and our friends and family members, and we need to support them. And even attracting health workers into jobs and alcohol services is difficult enough, so we need to do whatever we can to reduce stigma around that as well. I've witnessed myself in my professional career the negative consequences of using stigmatising language like addict, alcoholic, druggy and junkie, and this needs to change. In November last year, I picked this issue up with NES, National Education for Scotland, to ask if an online education module or modules could be created which could be aimed at teaching health and care staff who don't work directly in alcohol and drug services what stigma is and ways to address stigma. Health and care staff who don't work directly in the alcohol and drug services, they quite often come into contact with persons who engage in harmful use of illicit opiates and prescribed substances and alcohol as well. And online education could include allied health professionals such as pharmacists, physios and occupational therapists too. NES did respond to me saying that education modules were intending on being created, but I've not seen this on the ground yet. I'd therefore like to ask the Minister, is this something that is being taken forward, and any timescales for online modules completion and publication so that this education for health professionals that aren't working directly in the services can be taken forward? Even third sector organisations would benefit from anti-stigma advice and learning so that they can help engage and ensure persons can access the treatment they need without discrimination, prejudice and judgement. Again, accessible online learning could be a key way to help deliver anti-stigma education for professionals in healthcare across Scotland. So I do welcome the Minister's comments on this. Presiding Officer, I will now address naloxone and its provision in rural areas. And I welcome that during the pandemic, families of those who use opiates as well as other professionals who work in drug services have been allowed to supply take-home naloxone kits to anyone who might be more likely to witness an overdose. It is welcome that the intentions is that naloxone is being given to police officers across Scotland to assist with attending cases of suspected overdose. Across areas of rural Scotland, however, though, there have been concerns raised about the places for availability of naloxone and the number of people who are being given naloxone to use who are trained to use it. We know that naloxone via nasal delivery by the police that are trained and injection by others who are trained is the first-line defence against overdose. In Dumfries and Galloway, 30% of non-fatal overdoses are people who don't access services, so other places need to be considered in order to support delivery of naloxone kits. This has occurred in some places really successfully, like Aberlour and Dumfries. And so I asked the Minister if she can assist local ADPs to identify and assist with naloxone pickup available at sites where people do access sites that are less formal, non-medicalised places. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I ask the Minister to give an assurance that rural Scotland is absolutely part of Scotland's national drugs mission, and that people who live rurally have equal consideration for all pathways of treatment for their alcohol and drug harm, and continue to pursue this as a public health and not a criminal issue. And I again thank the Minister for this last year's work. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Harper. Now, call on Gillian Mackay, who also joins us remotely. She'll be followed by Stephen Kerr. Ms Mackay, around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too extend my condolences to anyone who has tragically lost a loved one to drug overdose. As the motion points out, drug-related deaths are tragic, preventable and an unacceptable loss of life. They are a symptom of people who use drugs being denied the rights and dignity that they are entitled to. I want to focus on the particular phrase from the motion that notes the need to continue to build on the work of the Drugs Deaths Task Force and other expert groups to implement evidence-led interventions that reduce deaths and improve lives. I think we can all agree that we need to improve the lives of people who use drugs. But I must put the question to those that oppose to harm reduction measures and decriminalisation: how can you improve someone's life by criminalising them? How can we take a human rights approach by prosecuting people for their addictions? Prosecution and punishment have no place in this conversation, and I'm reassured by the government's clear focus on intervention that will reduce harm and improve access to treatment and support. I'm pleased to see the recognition that safer consumption facilities are an important public health measure that could save lives. As members will know, in June last year, my amendment, which called on the Scottish Government to investigate as a matter of urgency what options it has to establish safe consumption rooms within the existing legal framework, was supported by the majority in this chamber. I'm very grateful for the Minister's update on this, and I sincerely hope that all stakeholders will engage with this in a constructive manner to ensure that we can save lives. The motion also recognises that no single intervention will be enough on its own, and this is crucial. We need a package of measures and a range of treatment options. It would be a failure of this Parliament to focus on one solution and ignore others. I accept that safe consumption rooms are not a silver bullet, but neither is any other intervention or treatment. I am concerned about the intense focus on residential rehabilitation. We, of course, need to expand provision of residential rehab, and everyone who needs and wants to access it must be able to do so. I've said before in this chamber that it will not be the right option for everyone, and it should not be prioritised over other treatment options. A truly person-centred approach to the drugs death crisis will recognise that people need to be able to access the treatment and support that works for them, and that drug use comes in many different forms. Constituents have expressed concerns to me about the fact that in conversations about drug overdose, opiates are often the focus, and not enough attention is paid to polydrug use and benzodiazepines. I know that work on this issue is already being carried out by the Drugs Death Task Force, but it is vital that we continue to highlight this in Parliament. Like others, I was concerned to hear of the resignation of the Chair and Vice-Chair of the Drugs Death Task Force. I'm grateful to the Minister for an update on a new Chair, and I sincerely hope that this will not stall the progress that is being made. The publication of the medication-assisted treatment standards was a huge step, establishing same-day access to treatment. This will reduce the risk of people dropping out of treatment and improve accessibility for vulnerable groups, such as people experiencing homelessness. There is also evidence that it reduces heroin use, HIV and hepatitis C risk, as well as overdose and criminal charges. The living experience of people in medication-assisted treatment was recently surveyed by a team of 13 researchers at the Scottish Drugs Forum. They found that access had improved as waiting times have reduced, although waiting periods were still too long, and that while some participants reported greater choice of medication, decisions around choice and dose were not always shared between the person and the prescriber. This suggests we still have some way to go before treatment is fully person-centred, but it is encouraging. I eagerly await further progress in this area as a step towards creating flexible treatment services that take account of an individual's circumstances, needs and, crucially, wishes. As we seek to improve the lives of people who use drugs, we must tackle infections such as hepatitis C, which are drivers of health inequalities. According to the Hepatitis C Trust, despite a dramatic interest in people completing treatment for hepatitis C in recent years, infection rates have not fallen. Around half of people who inject drugs have had the virus at some point, and one in four are currently infected, making hepatitis C the most common bloodborne infection for people who inject drugs. 90% of new infections occur through the sharing of contaminated injecting equipment. Safe consumption rooms would therefore be an important tool in the fight to reduce the spread of hepatitis C. The Trust is clear that efforts to eliminate hepatitis C will be wasted without the implementation of evidence-based harm reduction services, such as needle and syringe programmes, opioid substitution therapy and heroin-assisted treatment. We also need to increase knowledge and awareness of bloodborne viruses, which disproportionately affect people who inject drugs, including amongst those who work in addiction services. The Scottish Drugs Forum has said that the understanding and perceptions of frontline staff about HIV, for example, are often still informed by things that happened in and practice from the 1980s. And there is often a lack of understanding about new treatments, which mean that people can now live long, healthy lives, be at no risk of infecting their sexual partners. We need a dual approach which seeks to reduce the risk of people becoming infected, but also reduces stigma through education. As we progress through the national mission and look to next steps, I'd be grateful if we could begin to look at in depth how we can support families and children who have family members with drug or alcohol issues. Reducing adverse childhood experiences will ensure that we do not continue to perpetuate the trauma associated with drug and alcohol misuse. But above all, we need to respect the humanity of people who use drugs and restore the dignity, rights and choice that too many have been denied for too long. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call on Stephen Kerr, who will be followed by Paul Sweeney. Again, 6 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I congratulate all colleagues who have contributed to this debate? And there is a broad range of consensus across the Chamber on this issue. But I have to agree with colleagues on the far side of the Chamber, Michael Mara and Claire Baker in particular, that while it is important that we look forward and work together, it's important we understand what has happened in the past. And the function of this chamber is to act as a forum for democratic accountability. And therefore, I make no apology in reminding the chamber that the First Minister herself admitted in April 2020 that the government had taken its eye off the ball in relation to drugs deaths. And that's while we were experiencing 1,000 drugs deaths a year. And Jim Fairley may sigh out loud all he likes, but that's the nature of a parliamentary process, that we look at what has happened and try and understand from the mistakes that we made so that we can go forward with the consensus that we all seek on this very difficult issue. And so I was disappointed to learn from a Freedom of Information request that, for example, despite all of the rhetoric and despite all of the promises, the First Minister had not met any of the 31 drugs and alcohol partnerships since the election. I would have thought, given the emphasis that she has rightly put on this issue, that she would have found time to do that. And then we saw, just before Hogmanay, the resignation of Catriona Matheson and Neil Richardson from the Drugs Deaths Task Force. And I do welcome David Strang to his role and wish him well, but I think there are important questions to be asked in relation to comments made by Professor Matheson just last night on BBC's Reporting Scotland, where she seemed to cast doubt on the government's intent to create policy on the basis of evidence. For example, she said, and I quote, "If there's a rush to get things tied up, where does that leave the evidence? Is it about being seen to do something rather than doing the right thing? That is my concern." Now, many people will be very concerned to have heard those words on television last night from Professor Matheson. And then further on, in relation to the circumstances that led up to this, her resignation, Professor Matheson says, and that came straight out of the blue, and it was just 3 weeks after we'd received our letters of engagement for the second phase of engagement with the task force work, which stated in those letters of engagement that the work would go on until December 2022. Now, we know that, I think we've heard, that David Strang's work will go on until July 2022. Professor Matheson went on, so what was behind that? And it crossed our minds. Is this an attempt to kind of force our resignation and sideline the task force altogether? That was one consideration. And I think the Minister should take the opportunity to address these comments in this Parliament. Because Professor Matheson went on to make a far more serious comment, which was about the breakdown in the relationship between the Minister and the task force. We didn't have the full support of the Minister any longer, she says. And that ultimately made us concerned about what was driving this and the politics behind it, I suppose. The concern is that when politics comes into this, and that's across the political spectrum, and that's a point I accept, by the way, from Professor Matheson, unfortunately, the evidence and an evidence-based approach can get squeezed. I think the Minister perhaps could make a response to those comments for the sake of the record and for the information of this Parliament. And then, Alex Cole, yes.
Presiding Officer, let me take that opportunity and reassure Mr Kerr that the task force and the work that it has undertook receives my full support. And indeed, that is why I am seeking to implement, for example, the new medication-assisted treatment standards. And can I just say, you know, for the record, I wish Professor Matheson well. I thank her for her contribution. There is, of course, always a tension between acting on evidence that is never complete and acting now. And the reality is we have to find that balance and do both.
Stephen Kerr.
I thank the Minister for her comments, and I'll come back to the idea of action, which I think is what we all need to focus on, indeed, going forward. I would like to just recognise the comment that was made and offered by Alex Cole-Hamilton, who I don't think is in his place, that the figures that were released last week that showed the number of babies that have been born addicted to drugs, totaling 852, in fact, since 2017. And this is an important issue, which was brought home, I think, to many millions of people on all days, Christmas Day, in an episode of Call the Midwife. Many people, like speakers that have come before me, and including me, will not have seen the effects of children being born in those circumstances. And it brought vividly home all of the realities. I know it's only a drama, but often these mediums can be very powerful in terms of impacting in the public's mind, and in my mind especially, the reality of the suffering that is born included in that suffering are these newly born babies. The bottom line is, it's surely past time for the government to get a grip on this issue. It's very much a time for us to put firmly our eyes on the ball, and other political issues should indeed be set aside in favour of the national mission that a colleague over here described in great detail, and I was appreciative of the tone of his remarks. One of the things that concerns me, though, is whenever we debate this issue in this chamber, there is very quickly a resort to the old constitutional battle lines. It becomes a matter of lining up to blame someone else for things that we can and should be taking care of in Scotland, given the devolved powers that this Parliament and the Scottish Government enjoys. And therefore, I would appeal to colleagues not to fall into that habit, not to create those battle lines, to stop blaming, and realise that the last 15 years, more could have been done and should have been done and is now promised to be done. And I think the work of this Parliament and its various committees will be to gauge not just the tone of the rhetoric, the expressions of intent, all of which are good, the energy, indeed, that's being applied to the delivery of this rhetoric and these intentions. All of this is good, but at the end of the day, it will be what happens, what changes, and what improves that really matters.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Kerr. I now call on Paul Sweeney to be followed by CoCab Stewart again. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'd like to start by putting on record my thanks to the Minister for bringing this debate to the Chamber today, because I'm struggling to think of a more serious issue that we could be discussing in this Parliament. As has already been outlined by colleagues, 1,339 people have died of an avoidable drug-related death last year. And without action, I fear that number will increase again in the next set of figures. Now, I read the government motion with interest, and I am struggling to disagree with much of it. It's probably fair to say that there's broad consensus on the measures needed to tackle this crisis, but the concern I have is with the speed and pace of the change required. I intend keeping my remarks today to what I believe is the single most important change we could make, not the only, but the single most important change we can make, and that is the introduction of overdose prevention sites. That won't come as a surprise to the Minister, given our previous interactions and my personal experience of volunteering at the unofficial pilot project in Glasgow, and I welcome the Minister's intention to bring forward a revised proposal for an official pilot in the city to the Lord Advocate in due course. There are lots of assertions made about overdose prevention sites, whether they can be established within the existing devolution settlement, whether they are effective, and whether they will save lives. And put quite simply, the answer to all of those questions is yes. They can be established within the current devolution settlement, they are effective, and they will save lives. How do I know? Because I've seen it firsthand. I volunteered with Peter Crichton week in, week out, and was never arrested or charged with any offence, meaning that they can clearly be established within the current legal framework. If they were illegal, I would have been lifted and charged, meaning I likely wouldn't be standing here, and the fact is, I wasn't. I saw overdoses being reversed and over a dozen lives being saved in front of my eyes, so I defy anyone in this chamber to tell me that they don't work. The evidence is incontrovertible. And I saw vulnerable young men and women, failed by many other aspects of the state, being shown dignity, compassion and respect for the very first time, regardless of what traumas they had endured, leading them to substance misuse. But it can't just be left down to volunteers to fill the gap. Peter took into his care, as part of the unofficial pilot, a 21-year-old girl, and she overdosed in front of him three times. She was sleeping in a tent in an alleyway in Glasgow because she'd been sexually abused, and she was fearful of reaching out to any sort of care or official services because she'd suffered so badly previously as a result. And Peter frequently broke down because he was terrified that he would turn up the next day and she would be dead. And that culminated in him being triggered, because he was a recovering addict, to the point where he relapsed and his own life was then at risk. And I had to feel the fear of my friend potentially not picking up the phone to me. That's a lived experience for hundreds, if not thousands, of Scots. And it's something we cannot tolerate anymore. So that was another learning experience as a result of the unofficial pilot in Glasgow. And Deputy Presiding Officer, my heart breaks whenever I hear politicians from whatever side dismiss overdose prevention sites, or worse, when they hide behind constitutional grandstanding. Because every time they do, critical time is wasted, happy to give way.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful for the member for taking the intervention. I want to be absolutely clear here that when we're talking about the effectiveness of the services that he discusses, my reservation is around deployment of that resource. And I'd like to see the evidence that says that deployment of that resource is better in that particular way than it is perhaps in moving down upstream in other ways, because we have a finite resource. And also the issue around, in my constituency, is very rural, and how something the safe injection rooms would impact or wouldn't impact on the rural community.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank the member for his intervention. I don't stand here and make the point that it's a panacea, that it will be suitable in every set of circumstances. What I'm saying is that it does work, and evidence from over 90 cities in the world demonstrates that it works. The body of evidence internationally is incontrovertible. The evidence from the unofficial pilot in Glasgow is incontrovertible. Lives are saved. And for the relatively small and modest investment, the impact is significant. And it also leads people into a sense of engagement, which then leads them into a pathway potentially into recovery. So let us not make the perfect the enemy of the good here and raise expectations and set standards that people are doomed to fail to meet. Yeah. That is where we have to be, meeting people where they are at with their lived experience. The drugs are either taken in filthy alleyways or they're taken in sterile conditions. That's the choice before us today. And every 6 hours in Scotland, someone dies of a drug-related death. That means by the time we go to bed tonight, at least one more person will have died, leaving behind heartbreak and agony for their loved ones. And the frustrating thing is, Deputy Presiding Officer, that we know it is now possible. In evidence to the Scottish Affairs Committee in the House of Commons, the Law Society of Scotland stated that in order to establish overdose prevention sites, there would need to be either a change to the Misuse of Drugs Act, a UK government competence, or there would need to be a prosecutorial discretion from the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service not to prosecute in certain circumstances. Well, we now have that prosecutorial discretion. The Lord Advocate stood where the Minister is sitting just now, a matter of months ago, and set out that possession of substances classified under the Misuse of Drugs Act of 1971 would no longer be prosecuted. So what are we waiting for? Whilst I welcome the intention of the Minister to bring forward revised pilot proposals, we already have that body of evidence there, so we need to expand that rapidly into a national network. Deputy Presiding Officer, I don't doubt the sincerity of the Government or the Minister when it comes to this issue. I just think they are down a deep hole, having taken their eye off the ball for so long. But the reality is they're not moving fast enough, and some of the most vulnerable people in Scotland need them to move much faster. So to conclude, my message to the Government with regards to overdose prevention sites is pretty simple. Set them up, or I intend to introduce legislation in this chamber to make them to do so.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Sweeney. I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Cocab Stewart, after which we'll move into closing speeches, and everybody who's participated in the debate should be in the chamber. Ms Stewart, around 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I fully welcome this debate and the opportunity to reflect on what is one of the most complex and significant public health challenges that we currently face. Throughout this chamber and beyond, we've tried with great difficulty to process the heartbreaking statistics of drug-related deaths that continue to devastate the Scottish population. Each death, a son, a daughter, a parent who find themselves trapped in a vicious cycle and then tragically paid the ultimate cost, and my condolences go out to all of them and their families. According to research carried out by the Scottish families affected by alcohol and drugs, across both close family and wider social networks, that each individual using alcohol or drugs, an average of 11 people, were harmfully impacted. If you're a child of a drug user at the age of 5 years old, for instance, on average, their life is going to be affected well into approaching adulthood. It can take approximately 8 years for that child to reach family support for the first time, a combination of services unable to reach those in need, and the endemic stigmatisation of drug users in our society, which further deters individuals from seeking the help that they deserve. As such, I welcome the recognition that progress will not be achieved by one single intervention, but by a holistic, person-centred and multi-modal approach, which places dignity and respect at the forefront of accessible treatment and support services. As part of the Scottish Government's national mission to reduce drug-related deaths and harms, we have seen promising steps that will help to facilitate the required culture shift needed to tackle this crisis. One which appreciates the dangers of prejudice and focuses on funding evidence-led interventions that recognise addiction for what it is, not a moral failing, but a chronic disease. With thanks to work carried out by the Scottish Drug Death Task Force, the identification of key focus areas will serve as a crucial guide moving forward, and have already provided life-saving assistance through the expansion of naloxone provision. Consequently, it's not just clinical staff who are now trained in the supply of naloxone, but also 800 police officers, with 53 life-saving uses being administered throughout the 2021 pilot programme. Support has also been offered to charities like Scottish Families Affected by Alcohol and Drugs, allowing them to roll out an award-winning click and deliver naloxone service for family members and friends who could provide this valuable life-saving intervention. and over 4,700 kits have now been issued. In addition, and in continuing the valuable work of this task force, we must seriously consider any and all legislative reform that will reflect the mounting evidence of advantages of reduced criminalisation. The price of inertia is simply too high, and Professor Dame Carol Black's comprehensive independent review of drugs has confirmed that the current public provision for prevention and treatment and recovery in the United Kingdom is no longer fit for purpose. As the Misuse of Drugs Act is reserved to the UK government, and as present, we remain reliant on Westminster to determine that the legislation is incompatible with a public health response to problematic drug use. This is hardly reassuring, as time and time again, we have seen the Conservative government persist with draconian measures centred around harsh punishment for drug users, a tired hangover from the woefully outdated War on Drugs campaign of the 1990s. Nevertheless, I am hopeful that logic and compassion will prevail, and that the recommendations made by the Drug Death Task Force, including the introduction of safe consumption facilities and diverting more people away from the criminal justice system and into treatment and recovery services, will be translated into meaningful action. It's an issue which must transcend party politics. The role of any government is to protect the health and well-being of its citizens. And when such a disproportionate number of lives are lost each year, it is our duty to reflect on our approach, to accept responsibility and to implement change. We only need to look at countries like Canada, where the ongoing opioid epidemic sparked progressive drug policy reform in 2017, leading to the 39 supervised consumption sites which now operate across the country. In these facilities, between 2017 and 2019, out of 15,000 overdoses and medical emergencies, not a single fatality was reported on site. Why will the UK government not allow us to pilot this in Glasgow when it is clearly worked elsewhere? According to the National Harm Reduction Coalition, there are now more than 100 safe consumption sites located in over 11 countries worldwide, including Germany, the Netherlands, Switzerland, Spain and Australia. We cannot allow ourselves to be shackled by antiquated beliefs and must go where the evidence leads us to ensure that avoidable harms and fatalities are indeed avoided. And in conclusion, having had the opportunity to walk around my own constituency of Glasgow Kelvin with my colleague and Minister Angela Constance, we were both able to discuss the scale of the challenge we face. Nothing will improve overnight. However, by redirecting our energy and adopting a more humane approach to drug use and drug users, we can save lives and ensure that Scotland continues to build upon its reputation as a progressive and forward-thinking nation. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Stewart. We now move to the closing speeches, and I call Paul O'Kane for around 6 minutes. Mr O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In the summer of 2021, in one of my first speeches in this chamber, I spoke in a debate on this matter, and I spoke of the human cost of the drugs death crisis in this country, the families and friends who are left behind, the communities who feel broken. I think across the debate today, we have once again heard of that cost, and rightly our sympathies are with all those who have lost a loved one to drugs. I think we have also seen once again the consensus that exists in trying to find solutions. As Claire Baker, my colleague, outlined in her opening, there has been acknowledgement by the government of failure and a declaration of intent made, but it is now for us to scrutinise the progress towards that. Scottish Labour agrees that we need to take a public health approach, and so we have welcomed announcements made since January 2021, which could help reduce the number of drugs deaths and problematic drug use if implemented, and implemented with a degree of speed. It is clear that more needs to be done, and not least in light of the upheaval in the Drugs Death Task Force, which has been spoken about by colleagues today. However, I think in common with colleagues, I would want to welcome the appointment of David Strang and be hopeful that his appointment will see a greater focus on the connection between mental health, and substance misuse services, and indeed using that to, I think, achieve the MAT standards. Because I think, as we've heard in the debate today, those MAT standards are so important. And I think the questions that Claire Baker raised in her opening are key, particularly on progress to full implementation and the need for more support for health boards and IJBs, as highlighted by the Royal College of Psychiatrists. Michael Mara also spoke powerfully about Scottish Labour's support for MAT standards, but the need for greater progress and speed, particularly in his community of Dundee, which I know is so important to him, particularly around issues like same-day prescribing, and I do hope that the Minister will want to pick up on that in her concluding remarks. Going forward, Scottish Labour want to constructively consider all proposals that will reduce harm and support rights to access treatment. And we will, of course, carefully look at the detail of what is brought forward, including, of course, the Recovery Bill, which was outlined by Sue Webber on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Being a constructive partner, Deputy Presiding Officer, is being one that wants to show the way towards solution to the crisis, but wants to do that through honest assessment and honest conversations. And I think that will always be the approach that we on this side of the chamber will take, because we have been clear throughout about what we think we need to see. We need to see drug consumption facilities urgently progressed. And I just want to take a moment to highlight the contribution of my colleague Paul Sweeney, which I thought was characteristically powerful, as he spoke of his own experience supporting the work of Peter Crichton in Glasgow. And I think it's clear that we must listen to those experiences very carefully of what can be done, what can be achieved for people, and the reality of what taking that action means. And I really do hope that the Minister will further address what progress can be made in moving that agenda forward. Deputy Presiding Officer, I think it's clear that we also need further progress on heroin-assisted treatment to see the expansion of that through the country. And we need to see drug checking facilities urgently progress as part of harm reduction measures to address the drugs death crisis. These have all been measures which have been outlined by colleagues in their contributions, and it is clear that they can save lives. And while it's welcome that the government is planning to look at the introduction of facilities, I think we do have to ask ourselves why it has taken quite so long. Deputy Presiding Officer, I think consensus today in this debate has built on the need to move further and faster in recognising the crisis as a public health crisis. And Alex Cole-Hamilton, in his contribution, and indeed Paul McLennan in his remarks, I think really powerfully spoke about the need to reduce stigma and the stigma that still persists in so many communities across Scotland. Because we do have to replace the approach of the outdated criminal justice focus that we have seen in years gone by. And indeed, the Lord Advocate's statement on the expansion of the use of recorded police warnings is welcome. But it must be an enabler for getting people into better treatment and more services. It is clear, however, that to make the most of such a step, we need to ensure that there are sufficient resources made available to fund local services. And this is something that I've said in the Chamber before, but we need to ensure that local services are well funded, that local government continues to be funded to ensure that there can be a holistic approach to services across the piece. Indeed, in my own region, in West Scotland, we know that drugs deaths remain high, very high in Inverclyde, among the highest in the country. But we have seen the efforts of different organisations there to reverse that trend. And it is truly inspiring and shows what can be done to tackle the crisis when communities and health and care partnerships work together. However, it is abundantly clear that those services are struggling in terms of the funding that is available to them. I think we've heard about other interventions today, Deputy Presiding Officer, around the use of naloxone and increasing the availability of naloxone, particularly in rural areas. And as I begin to draw my remarks to a close, I think what is clear is that there is a consensus in this chamber about the actions that need to be taken. But it is clear that there must be robust scrutiny and strong critical friend of the government, essentially, in order to move this forward, because we know about the human cost of drugs deaths in this country. We know the pain that is caused to communities, and we know what must be done in order to move the national mission forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr O'Kane. I now call on Craig Hoy to conclude for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to start my contribution to today's debate by thanking those who have participated in it. The Minister, Angela Constance. I was going to say that in relation to her ministerial colleagues, the Minister is a breath of fresh air, and I think that is probably true, but particularly if she can match her words with actions, then I think we would all wish her well in that role, because Scotland will benefit. To thank Sue Webber and Emma Harper, Claire Baker, all good contributions, and Alex Cole-Hamilton, who talked about the neonatal effects of drugs, and I think that's an important issue that we should return to, and Paul McLennan, who talked of the 14 lives wasted in East Lothian last year, and I say wasted rather than lost, and also to thank Gillian Mackay and Cocab Stewart, and also Paul Sweeney, who quite rightly talked about the fact that this issue is probably the most important that we will discuss in this Parliament, and he talked about drug consumption rooms, something that I must say I was and probably still am sceptical about, but after hearing a speech of the quality of Paul Sweeney's today, I think we all have a duty to go away and to think seriously and to think again. Drugs are rightly an emotive issue, and while there will always be difference of opinion, I do not doubt the sincerity of anyone who seeks to limit the damage that they do. The debate has been an opportunity to reflect on the terrible toll that addiction takes and the damage caused by stigma. I was going to say that to people and their families, but actually I mean something much wider. It's close and extended family members, friends, your friends' families, colleagues, neighbours, and anyone whose life intersects with those unlucky enough to set down a path of drug addiction. Peaceful, loving homes destroyed by the strain caused by drug abuse, as Michael Marrow referred to in his hometown Dundee. And as Paul O'Kane said, life shattered and communities broken. Presiding Officer, as Stephen Kerr and Sue Webber pointed out, tackling drug-related deaths should unite this chamber. The need to tackle this should be a matter of consensus, but it doesn't, and I think Stephen Kerr was right in this, does not mean that we shouldn't level criticism where it is warranted. And we should remember that 2022 marks Scotland's 15th year under SNP rule, and sadly we know that over those 15 years, drug-related deaths have almost tripled. To their credit, however, the SNP has acknowledged that this is a huge issue, and I welcome the Minister's commitment to tackling it, and, as she said today, to developing a sharper focus and a shared understanding. I hope now the new national mission on drugs will start to change things. Brian Whittle talked of how the pandemic has exacerbated the issue, but there must come to a point where the pandemic on this and so many other issues is no longer used as a convenient excuse. I will take an intervention.
Jim Fairley.
I'd like to thank you for taking that intervention. I really do not mean this to be political in any way, shape or form, but I am going to come back to the point that Mr Whittle made about the Scottish Select Affairs Committee, where he cited that poverty wasn't necessarily the contributing factor. I've looked at the notes of that entire committee, and they keep talking about poverty being one of the main problems in driving addiction today. If we're going to find a solution, then we have to find the cause. And it is one of the main causes of drug addiction, and it's something that we have to tackle.
Craig Hoy.
I think when a politician tells you they're not going to be political, we should be sceptical. I think there's a dispute over the account there, but I will leave him and Mr Whittle to take that one out of this chamber. In Scotland today, drug users are still, sadly, unable to access the support they need. And as we have heard today, Scotland's drug death is 3.5 times worse than the rest of the UK and the worst in Europe. And people from the most deprived areas of Scotland are 18 times as likely to have a drug-related death than those in the least deprived areas. So there is clearly a link, but I'm not sure exactly precisely what that is, but I would welcome this House and others to look into it. We've heard today how the SNP has historically failed to support residential rehabilitation. And despite recorded drug deaths reaching a record high, just 7 more rehab beds were delivered across Scotland last year. In fact, the number of government-funded placements for residential rehabilitation declined throughout 2021. And in terms of what to do next, there still seems to be some level of confusion at the top of the Scottish Government. And I watched, like Mr Kerr, Professor Katrina Matheson on the TV news last night, and I saw the Minister too. And I do wonder whether or not, after years of inaction and cuts to frontline services, the Government is somehow now trying to make up for that. And we must be cautious to make sure that doing something fast means that it will necessarily be effective. Scotland's appalling high number of drug deaths is a national shame, and that's why the Scottish Conservatives are bringing forward a right to recovery bill to ensure the right to life-saving treatment for addiction is enshrined in law. And we are very grateful to everybody who has taken the time to respond to our consultation, and we are delighted that the proposals have received an overwhelmingly positive response. I have a sense still, despite this action, that the Scottish Government are not taking the issue seriously enough. And I would therefore urge the Government to support our bill when it comes forward. I also encourage the Government to work closely with the third sector, with alcohol and drugs agencies, with the police, with the NHS and with the prison service, because they all have vast experience in this area. Working together, we can, I believe, right the wrongs. We can never reverse the damage done in the past, but we can reverse the recent trends. We can prevent drug addiction and end this national disgrace once and for all. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Hoy. I now call on the Minister to conclude the debate. I'd be very grateful if you could take us up to our own decision time, Ms Constance.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I also start by thanking members for their contributions and thank members across all political parties, because the support and scrutiny of Parliament I very much do welcome and appreciate it. Because that will help us build on the foundations, it will help us push on, it will help us scale up, and it will help us all drive change and improvement through the second year of the national mission and beyond. Can I also say to Mr Kerr and also Mr Sweeney, much to the annoyance of many of my colleagues, you rarely hear me mention the Constitution in a drugs debate. I do not, of course, ignore the impact of things like the Misuse of Drugs Act, which I believe limits our public health approach. But I hope you would agree that much of my attention has a really disproportionate focus on the powers and the opportunities that we do have here in Scotland. Now, there are lots of points that I wish to address, and I'll do my best to do that. If the Liberal Democrat amendment had been accepted by the presiding officer, I would indeed have accepted that, Mr Cole-Hamilton. And one of the things I will do this year is bring forward our approach and plans around stabilisation services. That fits with some of our work in and around national procurement. And I'm sure you'll also have noted the National Residential Family Service that we are supporting financially that will open later on this year, as well as our dual housing support fund, which is to ensure that people do not have to choose between maintaining their place in residential rehabilitation and their tenancy. In terms of the Tory amendment, I very much welcome and support the comments around the voluntary sector, which I have given long-term funding commitments to, and also the remarks that have been made in and around prevention. Okay, briefly.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the assurances that she's just made to me through her remarks. I just wonder if she can confirm to the Chamber that residential rehab is not an exact science, it's not a hotel, and sometimes occupancy will dip well below a normally sustainable level. And can she confirm that these services will be supported when they lie fallow sometimes?
Minister.
It's a valid point, but I think there is more we can do to ensure that we utilise existing capacity and build on that capacity too. With reference to our colleagues in the Conservative benches, the only reason that I can't support your amendment today is I fear it is trying to get me to give 100% guarantee to sign up to a bill that I've not yet seen. But let me reassure you that your bill, along with Mr Sweeney's, if he brings
through
it forward,
the chair, please, Minister.
Indeed, Presiding Officer. Let me assure Chamber Presiding Officer that Mr Rossi's bill and Mr Sweeney's bill, if he brings forward propositions, will always be given a very fair hearing from this government indeed, because I've said time and time again there is no monopoly of wisdom and we are trying to march forward together. In terms of the Labour Party, I agree with much of the direction of travel that's in your amendment. It's just unfortunate it deletes all of mine, but I do think we have some common ground. Certainly.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. It is an insertion. It doesn't actually delete the government's motion. The proposal is to. It makes a rather long motion at the end of the day, but it is an insertion.
Minister.
I think if I read it correctly, it deletes after line one. Or the effect of the insertion is that it removes all of my motion apart from line one. Presiding officer, one of the issues that I have addressed repeatedly over the past year is why Scotland, but let me do so again for the record, for Chamber. There are three reasons why we have the unenviable position of having one of the worst drug-related death rates in the world, if not the worst. Reason number one is that the prevalence of drug use and problematic drug use in Scotland is almost double what it is south of the border. Now, there is an existential question as to why that is, and I'm not going to seek to address it between now and decision time, but it does touch upon prevention, it does touch upon the need for diversion, and at its core, it touches upon why we have a national mission that seeks to join drugs policy at the hip with education, the work to address adverse childhood experiences, the work to address poverty and inequality, the work to make our justice system more humane, the work that we do to empower the voluntary sector, and the work to address homelessness and mental health as well. The second issue is around benzodiazepines. The benzodiazepines is an issue across the UK, absolutely will not deny that. But if you compare Scotland to England, the implication of benzodiazepines in drug-related deaths has increased since 2009 by 450%. South of the border, that's 50%. And I think while I would have a different opinion from Mr Mara as to why we have seen that increase, what I will say, we absolutely need a better treatment offer. That's why we're bringing forward the work on stabilisation services, and it's also why we need more of a consensus amongst clinicians, but certainly.
Michael Mara.
I'm the Minister addressing this question. I mean, I suppose my concern with it is that we should explore the why this has happened, because it's my understanding that this is a public policy issue that's partly been created by the removal of Valium scripts. And we have to make sure that we don't open other Pandora's boxes in the same way. If we don't learn the lessons of things that we have done wrong as a country, then we will repeat them.
Minister.
And I agree with that. And that's why we need a consensus amongst clinicians. And that clinicians, they're not the only part of this, but they are a key part in terms of taking an evidence-based approach moving forward. And the third reason... presiding officer, and I'm going to be very candid and very blunt, we do not have enough of our people in treatment. And that is largely on us. And I have never sought to deny that. And that is why at the very core of a national mission is to get more people into treatment or recovery that is right for them, not right for me, not treatment or recovery that suits any of our ideological positions, but treatment or recovery that suits the needs of individuals. And that takes me on to harm reduction and residential rehabilitation, because we have sought a very balanced approach here. You know, we need to be... this isn't a stultified debate between recovery versus harm reduction. Actually, it's all of the above and more. And I will accept that in terms of residential rehabilitation, I know this from my time in social work, that we start from a low base. What I will say is that in the first part of 2021, there, with the additional funding released by the government, there was 212 residential placements funded. That is almost the same as the funded placements in the entirety of 2019. I accept that this is a small indication of a forward move, and that we do indeed have some way to go. We need to see year-on-year improvements to reach that goal of 1,000 publicly funded residential care placements per year. And I often hear dreadful statistics quoted back to me in news articles and in debates. And actually, I've published most of those statistics because I've been determined that we will shine a light on where there are gaps or indeed or where there are no care pathways. Similarly, if I can address some of the issues around harm reduction, given the very important briefings that we all received from the Hepatitis C Trust and the Royal College of Psychiatry. Can I just say that the actions they seek are very much part of my agenda, and I give that reassurance to Gillian Mackay. And I've also never demurred from the fact that implementing MAT standards is absolutely crucial, but it is an absolutely massive task. And can I say to Paul McClelland and Claire Baker, that is why, like with the work that we have done with residential rehabilitation, we will indeed publish that granular detail, area by area, about the progress that has been made post-April at my next parliamentary update specific to MAT standards. But I am serious about this. We need to embed. All won't be well after April, and we'll need to improve, and we'll need to sustain that improvement. But that is why we have increased the MIST team, so there is more hands on deck to assist with that work. We've increased the funding that's available to support that work. And can also say, just briefly, because I'm conscious that time is short, that I pay very close attention to what happens in the great city of Dundee. We do indeed need to do more to turn expressions of interest on heroin-assisted treatment into hard commitments, but the evaluation of the Glasgow project, which will be published at the start of this year, I think will help with that. And I just want to say to Mr Sweeney that I always really enjoy his contributions and your call to go where angels fear to tread. But the work around overdose prevention facilities is detailed and delicate work. I am having to find ways to do this within our own powers. And the Lord Advocate made very clear to the Justice Committee about what needs to be addressed prior to her considerations, and that is exactly what I am working on. And I'll correspond with Ms Baker on the issues around drug checking facilities. And just finally, Presiding Officer, just to say thank you very much once again to everybody who has participated. We have made progress with other preventable deaths, so change is possible. Change is not always comfortable, and nor should it be, and I don't make any apologies for that. But I will also say that there is not one group, not one MSP, not one minister who is bigger than the national mission. This is a collective and cross-cutting endeavour, and we have laid important foundations, but we still have 1,001 bricks to lay. And we will lay those bricks, one by one, putting words into actions, and we'll build a better Scotland, one that leads and not one that lingers.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on tackling drug-related deaths through the first year of the National Mission, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business. And there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Amendment 2761.2, in the name of Sue Webber, which seeks to amend Motion 2761 in the name of Angela Constance on tackling drug-related deaths through the first year of the National Mission, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote, and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.